These days, the word sustainability gets thrown about all the time, and people don't look at what we think is the most fundamental root of it, and that's how to live with other people, how to share resources, how to share space, how to share things. And so we teach both skills that people can kind of do it themselves so they're more self-sufficient, but then teach people also how to be more community interdependent, so how to rely on each other. There's 16 people who live here, 16 adults and 6 kids who live here full-time. And then we kind of exemplify the things that we're teaching about how to live in community and how to live sustainably. Well, it's kind of a hard question because, you know, like this, meaning the nonprofit and the intentional community, have been around for about 4.5-5 years. Before that, this land was a rental for about 15 years. Before that, it was lived in by the family who owned it while it was a rental. Before that, it was a family farm from about 1925 on. But the nonprofit got started when the land was threatened with becoming a housing development. The people who had owned it for about 35 years wanted to sell, and they thought the best way they could make money was to sell to developers. And those of us who lived here or were connected to it said, oh my goodness, no, that is not the best use of this land. It's such a unique place. I mean, 7 acres of farm inside of 700 acres of forest, you know, inside the city. So we decided that we needed to promote an alternative, nice mushrooms, and started a land acquisition campaign. And it's a long, epic saga of a story. We got evicted. We found a loophole to stop the eviction and got to stay here. We bought out the developer who already had an interest in the land. We raised $1.5 million in 10 months. We had babies. The land acquisition was completed in 2006, January 2006. So we're about to celebrate the 3rd anniversary of it. We do have $6,000 a month mortgage payments. And the way that's split up is that the community pays $4,000 a month and the nonprofit pays $2,000 a month on the mortgage. And the land itself is owned by a land trust. But we also find that because we pool all of our resources together, it's not like one person holds a mortgage, and if they lose their job, then we're going to lose the land. It's a lot more secure because we have community buy-in and collective responsibility. So amongst the residents, there are a few residents who are having a hard time putting their contribution. Okay, get down. Putting in their contribution to the mortgage, so they basically take a loan from the community until they can pay it off, and we're able to support each other that way. So in that aspect, I think we're way more secure than, you know, nuclear families or single family residences who have one wage earner, who if they lose their job, that's it. It's amazingly beneficial to have an economy of scale where, like when our laundry machine broke, we each kicked in $25 and were able to buy a really super efficient, environmentally friendly, high-tech washing machine. And we all share food, and so we buy from a bulk wholesale organic place that, and you know, we grow a lot of our own too, but we each pay $4 a day for food, and we eat just epically wonderful local organic food. And because we share, we're able to make everything cheaper for each of us. I've also never paid for childcare. I think one of the things I've learned, and I think we've kind of learned collectively as a community, is one of the most important aspects of sustainability is learning how to make decisions together and resolve conflict positively, because it comes up. And so we put a lot of time into learning how to speak very honestly, very directly, have a lot of respect for each other, and have, you know, we meet as the residential community every week, and we work through things. And that's, we're finding that skill is becoming more and more in demand as people realize, like, we have to share. You know, we don't really have a choice anymore with the resources and the economy going the way they are. Well, two things. One is our community meetings happen every week regardless of what's going on, and there often isn't any kind of tension or conflict. And we make our decisions through consensus process, and we alternate every week between a meeting of the minds and a meeting of the hearts. So we do businessy stuff on one week, and then we'll get into deeper, like, any personal issues or deeper check-ins, or give just more time to a topic in meetings of the heart. But in terms of actual conflict resolution, we do have protocols. We even have a group, a working group of the, it's kind of a blend between the nonprofit and the community. It's the only working group that's a blend of the two. It's called Social Ecology. And their whole focus is to look at how the energy and relationships are going. It's like a kind of hippie human resources group. And they look at, you know, what, how are the systems? What are the structures? Right now we're really discussing like the tension between autonomous action and collective decision making. So how to empower people to do things autonomously, because there's so many projects going on in the land and there's so many people who work on it. People who live here and then all sorts of people who don't. Ooh, you found two eggs. Awesome. And so trying to figure out how to balance people feeling empowered just to do the things versus checking in with other people who might have an idea about how things should be done. And so like, figuring out that dance is a big question where we're at right now. And luckily we have a couple people here who are just, I don't want to say obsessed with, but deeply interested in process, very interested in process. And it helps because, you know, no matter what we were talking about, we'd bring it back to the question of, well, how does this affect our long-term ability to work with and live with each other? And so, you know, it's a kind of a unique situation because there is no just like going home, you know, and shutting the door and all that other stuff is out. Like, home is where we have massive projects going on. You know, we run a farm, we run a nonprofit, we run a community, and we all work outside it. Like, there isn't just this, relaxed time to unwind. So we have to be able to be comfortable with each other. And I think that pressure makes us take it more seriously than a lot of people do. If they can just like leave their workmates behind and those unsatisfactory relationships and go home, you know, and shut their door and isolate themselves. Yeah, we're not really given many positive examples of conflict resolution in our culture. We're finding, you know, I mean, we have ample opportunities to resolve conflicts here. And so we're getting better and better. You know, we recognize that not everybody's going to, you know, start living collectively. But I think everyone could take steps to build community in all the places where they live, where they work, where they worship, things like that. Just invite your neighbor over for dinner, you know? Invite your other neighbor over for dinner. Start doing neighborhood potlucks, you know, and start building community just around the people you live. You don't have to agree with them on politics. You don't have to, you know, agree with them on lifestyle. But if you really need something, they're next door. So that's something that's really easy that people can start doing. And then if they want, they can take it to the next level, like taking fences down. I mean, how do we create more green space in Portland? Take the fences down between our houses. And all of a sudden, there would be so much more collective green space to share. Start a neighborhood tool library so everyone didn't need to have their own everything. Or start a neighborhood fruit stand if everyone started growing a few vegetables or just a barter system amongst them. So there's so many different things that people can do just on a neighborhood scale that we're doing here if they just start reaching out to each other and learning how to rely on each other. Because I think we're getting to a time when, I mean, we can't rely on the government to save us. We can't rely on our cash to save us. Like, in the Great Depression, it was a great community building time. Like, we had to rely on each other. And we can do it, you know? The thing that we're going to be bumping into is not, like, a lack of people who can do cool stuff and a lack of people who need cool stuff. It's the medium to exchange. And there's work that people are doing here at the farm to build community economic networks so people can have direct exchange and things like that. And so I think there's a lot of just little things people can incorporate into what they're doing to make their lives more communitarian and more sustainable and just more fun too. You're not so lonely when you like know the people who live near you and know that you have a network of support if you need it. We're not doing this just for us. Like, that's right. The whole point is to make it so other people can take and incorporate these into their lives. So the more we're out there, the better.